Have you ever stopped and wondered to yourself, why do we burp?
Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Our burps are really nothing more than extra gas finding its way out of our body. In this case, our mouths. It might be gross, but it's also a normal way for our bodies to get rid of all the extra air we swallow throughout the day. You see, every time we swallow a bit of food or sip a beverage, we swallow little bits of air along with whatever we're actually trying to eat or drink. That air is mostly made up of gases, mainly nitrogen and oxygen, which end up inside our stomach along with everything else we swallow. Over time, the gases start to build up more and more until there's too much and it's gotta get out. So, some gas is squeezed out the stomach back up into the esophagus, the tube that connects our mouth to our belly. From there, the gas is pushed up the esophagus and out through the mouth in the form of a burp. Disgusting and cool. That's also why we tend to start burping a lot more when we sip on a fizzy drink. All those sparkling bubbles in your beverage are just bits of carbon dioxide gas. That's why we call bubbly drinks carbonated. All that carbon dioxide you're drinking down quickly collects in your stomach and causes you to start burping it back out almost immediately. You can also cause yourself to burp by eating or drinking too fast. As you quickly chow down on a snack, you're swallowing way more air with every bite than if you took your time with smaller bites. Same goes for a straw. All that extra air you swallow with each sip causes extra burps. The good news? Burping is rarely a health problem. It's just usually pretty gross, and in certain situations, downright rude. But it's also natural. So don't fret if you need to burp after sucking down an entire extra large soda in one sip. Just, you know, try to choose your spots. When you're extra hungry and all you can think about is getting something to eat, your belly tends to rumble. But why do our bellies growl when we're hungry? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Well, it turns out that there's a scientific term for the sound your stomach makes, borborygmi, which is a Greek word that's an onomatopoeia, meaning the word is supposed to sound like the noise it's describing. All that rumbling and growling you hear in your belly is coming from either your stomach or intestines, and it happens to everyone. Usually we associate a rumbling belly with an empty stomach, but sometimes it can rumble even if you aren't hungry. You see, whenever you eat food, the muscles in your digestive tract push the food through your intestinal tubes, breaking it down and absorbing the food's nutrients. Your intestines are one long hollow tube that runs from your mouth all the way to your butt. The walls are made of smooth muscle that squeeze and expand to mush up the digesting food. As the food is broken down, gas and bubbles of air get mixed in, and little pockets of air and gas cause that squeezing to make a rumbling sound. The noises are usually more muffled when your stomach is full because the food absorbs most of the sound. But when your belly is empty, those rumblings are much louder and easier to hear. An hour or two after a meal, your stomach will send signals to your brain, letting it know that you're full and it's time to fire up the digestive system. The sounds start again a few hours later, when your belly is looking to digest more food. So, it fires up the old stomach contractions, just to check and see if anything got left behind from before. Okay, so that's how stomach growls work, but we all know when we're hungry. So why does our body also make sounds to let us know? Well, the feeling of your stomach contracting and trying to digest food that isn't there is awfully uncomfortable. That growly feeling of an empty stomach is a great motivator to get up and go find some food. If you've ever slept near anyone who snores, you know how annoying it can be. But what actually causes us to snore? And is there anything we can do to stop it? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Snores are big, deep noises that come out of our noses while we sleep. That can keep people nearby awake, and at worst, be loud enough to wake ourselves up, or even wake someone up in another room. About half of us will snore at some point throughout our lives, so it's something you're likely gonna encounter one way or another. For some, snoring is a constant problem every night, and others just snore from time to time or very rarely. So what actually causes them? Well, you snore whenever air can't move easily through your nose and mouth while you sleep. If the air can't move freely out, it will burst out, kind of like a volcano of air from your nose, causing vibrations that make the classic snoring sound. There's all sorts of different things that can cause you to snore. Blocked airways or a stuffy nose are a common cause because they make it hard for air to flow naturally. Allergies, colds, or infections are often the cause of a night spent snoring. But you can also snore simply because of the way you're built. Guys have naturally narrower air passages than women, making them more likely to snore. Being overweight doesn't help either. Fat around the neck and throat can cut off air, leading to that terrible sound. Okay, so we know why we snore and what can cause it, but how do we avoid snoring altogether? If your nose is stuffed up, make sure to try and clear it out before bed. You can try some new sleeping positions too. Keep your head up about 6 or so inches while laying in bed with an extra pillow, and try sleeping on your side instead of your back. This helps you breathe easier and will keep your nose from getting stuffed back up too fast if you're sick. Living healthy also helps a lot. Losing weight and exercising have both been shown to help people from snoring as often, and avoiding fatty foods and dairy right before bed can help too. And as annoying as snoring can be, it's hard to say if it's worth giving up that late night bowl of ice cream just to stop snoring. Most of us have heard it before. If you crack your knuckles, you're gonna get arthritis when you're older. So, is there any truth to that? Or is it just a myth that cracking your knuckles is bad for you? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Despite the persistent rumors, research has shown that cracking your knuckles daily doesn't increase your chance of getting arthritis or any other knuckle problems as you age. The most famous study on the subject was done by a doctor named Donald Unger, who spent over 60 years just cracking the knuckles on his left hand and never cracking the knuckles on his right to see if there was any difference. In 1998, he published his research. His left hand was perfectly fine and had no noticeable effects from a lifetime of daily knuckle cracking. Okay, so it might not be such a big deal to crack your knuckles, but there is one question still lingering. What actually causes the noise you hear from your knuckles? Even though we call it cracking our knuckles, what we're really doing is actually making a bunch of little pops. They're caused by tiny bubbles in your synovial fluid, which is just the fancy name for the fluid in between your joints that keeps your bones from scraping together. Think of it a little bit like bubble wrap. When you crack your knuckles, it squeezes those microscopic bubbles that build up in the fluid, and they all pop, making that distinct, oddly satisfying knuckle cracking noise. But like all things satisfying, moderation is key. You can only crack your joints once every 15 or 20 minutes because it takes some time for the gases to dissolve back into the joint fluid. So whether you find the sound satisfying or horrifying, you can rest assured it's perfectly safe to crack your knuckles. Unless it happens to bother your older brother. Today, we're tackling a tired question that's not so easy to answer. Why do we yawn, and why are they sometimes contagious? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Humans start yawning super early in life, as in before we're even born. That's right. Modern technology has shown that babies inside the belly can yawn and hiccup for at least 6 months before they're born. We also don't just yawn when we're tired. Studies have shown that we yawn when we're getting sleepy or waking up, or really any time that our level of alertness is changing. Experts still aren't exactly sure why we yawn, but there's been plenty of theories throughout the years. The ancient Greek doctor Hippocrates, who is known as the father of modern medicine, believed that you yawned right before you got sick as a way to remove bad air from the lungs. But years of scientific discovery tell us that Hippocrates probably had that wrong. By the 1700s, experts in Europe began to believe that yawning was a reflex meant to increase your blood pressure, heart rate, and oxygen levels in order to be extra alert. But once again, more modern science has shown that heart rate, sweating, or electrical activity in the brain doesn't increase when you yawn. So that theory is out. Today, some experts believe that yawning might just be another way for us to communicate. If that's true, then yawns are a nonverbal way to show changes in our mood or surroundings. That's why yawns can be contagious. When we see someone else yawn, it can cause us to feel what that person is feeling and communicate it back with a yawn of our own, almost like a conversation between our bodies that we never decided to have. Pretty weird, huh?